I love Pastor Ron. Pastor Ron and I want to welcome everyone first to the Log Church and also at the cafe. We're so glad that you're here. Pastor Ron and I are kind of the same in that neither of us are particularly musically talented, but we hear the band, and like for a minute we think we can sing or do something. So like in the back, what you missed from the back is Harry, the drummer, got out and left. And when he came out, I was standing in the back and I had a pair of sunglasses on, and I went, like pretend like I was, that was the closest I can get to play the drums right there. So, but I pretend that I can do it, but I know I can't. So I'm really thankful that we have talented people that take care of that for us. But I should actually probably preach this sermon. All right, let's do this. I want you to imagine that early scene in the video there. I want you to pretend like you are the one being interviewed for a moment. And I'm going to ask you a series of questions. I want you to answer them honestly. We're not going to ask you to answer them out loud. For those of you that are like, you know, the kind of learner that you need to be doing something with your hands, you can write this on the back of your note sheet. But I'm going to ask you a series of questions. Okay, here's the first one. Ready? Who has hurt you? Who has hurt you? That's the first question. Doesn't have to be somebody recently. Could be somebody from your past. Could be somebody that was in a professional relationship you had, or somebody in a personal one. Who is it that's hurt you? That's the first question. The second question. How often do you think of that person? Do you think of them couple times a year? Do you think of them a couple times a month? Do you think of them weekly? Do you think of them daily? And when you're thinking of them, how often does that offense, that pain that they cause you, how often does that replay itself? That's your second question. Now, the last question is this. Are you willing to forgive them? Are you willing to exercise forgiveness? And if not, why? How you answer those questions is going to determine how you're going to receive what we have to talk about over our time together. Because when a preacher talks about forgiveness, it is so easy. I mean, this is like, there's really complicated stuff that we can preach about. Like, the last 4 weeks we talked about the laws of the harvest and sowing and reaping, and that's kind of complicated, about sowing seed that you reap in a different season, sowing more than you, or reaping more than you sow, all that stuff. That's complex stuff. We could talk about theology, we could talk about the doctrines of the Godhead and the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and that's hard, that's heavy, and there's different ways we can look at that and present it. Then we could talk about things like prophecy and what's going to happen at the end times and, you know, different components of that and how exactly the Lord's going to return. That stuff is heavy to preach. But forgiveness, dude, my job today, it's easy. It's really easy. Because the Bible's so clear about how we ought to approach forgiveness, and the Bible's very clear on what our stance ought to be concerning forgiveness. However, one thing you should take note of is this. Forgiveness is the most practical and most difficult way to display your faith. It's so easy to preach about, but it is so difficult to practice. So difficult to practice. There's no good way for me to teach you how to apply it, but it's easy for me to teach you that you need it. And so today, what we're going to do is I'm praying, and this is what I prayed all week. This is what I prayed in every service. And I believe that God is going to do a great thing here. I've had a couple people, and this is nothing to do with me as a preacher, because I'm not particularly good at anything. But one thing I know is that when people forgive and when people allow their hearts to be released from a spirit of bitterness, their lives are changed. And this morning I had somebody that was leaving the church and they were in tears and they said, my life has changed. Like literally, in that moment, my life has changed. And it's my goal, whether you're here at the cafe today, that God does a great healing here and helps you to comprehend the power of forgiveness. So how we're going to do this is we're going to go to an Old Testament story about King David. Now, most of you know the story of David, and I'm going to give a little bit of a paraphrase to his story. David, this is before he was king. He was chosen by God, anointed to be God's great king. The problem with this is that Israel already had a king, King Saul. And believe it or not, other kings aren't really fond of the idea that they're going to be succeeded by another ruler. On top of that, Saul became easily jealous of David because, number one, David was really, really good looking. Number two, David was extremely charismatic. He had a really high favor with the nation of Israel. Number three, David was a brilliant military strategist. David had leadership characteristics wherever he went. He was a leader, okay? And Saul became extremely jealous of him. Even though Saul was his father-in-law, David married Saul's daughter, which proves my point that in-law relationships are always going to be bad. No matter how holy you are, it doesn't make a difference. There's no good that can come from in-laws. I'm just being serious, don't worry. But David had this unbelievable spiritual connection, and Saul degraded over time in his connection spiritually to the point that Saul found that it would be easier to kill David than to live with David agitating him and making him jealous for the rest of his life. So Saul tries to murder him. David, instead of fighting him, which David could have easily done, David flees the kingdom. David runs for his life. And David takes refuge in many different areas. The area that David finds himself in our story is a hiding area that it's called En-Gedi. This area is a mountainous area. You could Google this if you want in your phone. I don't care if you do it now, but if you stay on there for longer than 2 minutes, I'm going to be offended. It's a mountainous area. And last night, I don't know what I was thinking. I said, the reason why this was a good place is because it had a lot of running water. And I'm like, what running water? No, it didn't. It didn't have running water back then. Like, I don't know. I jumped a couple centuries ahead. But it had a lot of streams of water in there. So it would be easy for them to be able to get sustenance and be protected. They had good Wi-Fi there too, I understand. I don't know. But David hid there because it would be easy to survive. Also, there were caves, so it's easy to hide and rest and find shade. It was like the perfect hiding place. And it's beautiful. It's a beautiful area that's even beautiful today. So that's the area of En-Gedi. David's hiding there. He has a group of people, these ragtag followers that he's adopted. These are kind of like the dregs of society that are helping him. And we'll explain a little bit more about them in a moment. So David runs to this area, and he's protected in anonymity. Saul is pursuing him all over the place. Saul is looking for a place to take a rest. Saul also stumbles upon the area of En-Gedi. And while David is there, unbeknownst to Saul, Saul leaves the army and he goes up into the mountains where David is and he goes into a cave. The Bible says that Saul then proceeds to cover his feet. That's a really fancy Hebrew way of saying Saul had to make a poo-poo, okay? Sorry. I just have to make this real plain for you to understand, okay? Very vulnerable situation, very bad situation for Saul. He goes into the cave, David is there, and David has the opportunity beyond a lifetime. Saul has no defense, Saul is vulnerable, Saul is taking a break in there, and then Saul is going to go ahead and take a nap in the cave as well. And David has the opportunity to end this feud once and for all. And that is where our story begins. This is the story. We're going to examine this morning three things that this trip to En-Gedi is going to teach us about forgiveness. Because if you're a Christian, you need to know about forgiveness. Forgiveness is important. Forgiveness is vital for us to live the life that God has called us to live. If we don't have it, we need it. If we can't extend it, then we have a problem because maybe we haven't received it. But I'm going to teach you today how to glean a message from En-Gedi. And there's three things that you want to know. The first is this. Number one, listen to your conscience instead of the crowd. Listen to your conscience instead of the crowd. So David is there. Saul's asleep. It says in 1 Samuel chapter 24, verse 4, it says, the men of David said to him, those are David's buddies, here is the day of which the Lord said to you, behold, I will give you your enemy into your hand, and you shall do to him as it shall seem good to you. Then David arose and stealthily cut off a corner of Saul's robe. David has his friends there, and David's friends are like, dude, This is the perfect situation. This is like a divine grapefruit that God is throwing at you. All you have to do is kill this guy, and you're not going to be sleeping in a cave tonight, bro. We're going to the palace. I mean, the kingdom is yours. This is like black and white, clear as day. God has given you this clear-cut opportunity to end this feud forever and take what's rightfully yours. Now, I must explain that David's friends were not necessarily the godliest people that you would ever want to meet. In fact, these were like the dregs of society. David met them while he was being a fugitive. Remember what I said earlier? Wherever David was, he became a leader. So when David was in the military, David was a military leader. When David was in politics, David was a political leader. David was a shepherd, and he was leading sheep. I know that's kind of a stretch, but he was not becoming a sheep, but he was a shepherd and leading sheep. David's just a natural-born, God-given leader, and that's what was in him. So he had these people that he's been caring for and that he's been loving and that they've been taking care of him and helping him, and they're like, this is it. Now, the way I kind of always associate these people in my mind, and I still do even from the first time I read this story, whenever I read this story, what I think of is, do you remember the original Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the claymation one? Remember, how many of you saw that? Raise your hand. Okay, I'm not lying. Early service. I was like, how many of you know Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer? There's one person. They were like, what is this Rudolph that you speak of? This mythical figure that I know not of. Like nobody, I'm like, you never saw, really? I'm like, please leave right now and go watch Rudolph. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the claymation one with Burl Ives, the snowman, all that stuff. Great stuff, okay? Rudolph had a friend, and remember the elf, the friend who was an elf? Okay, what was the elf's problem? The elf didn't want to be an elf that made toys. What did he want to do? Be a dentist, right? What was the elf's name? Somebody said, Hermie. Oh, man, you guys, you're really a little too enthusiastic about Rudolph. This is a problem that the early service didn't have. Okay, we got to tone this down. There's bigger things in life than Rudolph. Take it easy. Okay, but through the movie, at the beginning of the movie, all Hermie does, like, I want to be a dentist. I want to be a dentist. I don't want to make toys. And everyone's like, what? You remember the weird boss? Yeah, you want to be a dentist? And he's like, you know, they're angry at him. And then, so what happens? He ends up with Rudolph, the weird reindeer that has the red nose, and they go to that special place. Does anybody remember where they end up going? The Island of the Misfits. Yep, Misfit Toys. Man, oh man. I wish you guys knew your Bible the way you know this movie. Make this job so much easier. Come home, Pastor Mike. So they go to the Island of the Misfit Toys. And the Island of the Misfit Toys is loaded with, like, all these different toys. Like, you know, the doll that doesn't talk right. There's, the squirt gun that doesn't squirt water. It squirts, like, grape jelly. And then there's, like, instead of a Jack in the Box, there's a Charlie in the Box. Nobody wants to be a Charlie in the Box. One of the band, this is what the band does when I'm preaching. While I was preaching this in the last service, the band members were texting me different characters they wanted me to try to imitate from the Island of the Misfit Toys. So, but Rudolph and Hermie, they end up, you know, getting this rallying people together, and they're all misfits, they all have different stories. Well, that's essentially what is going on with David, to bring this really long circle back to the sermon, that David has this group of people, and they all they really care about is David. And they're like, come on, David, I mean, this is your guy, you got to kill him. I mean, this is real easy. We'll help you. We'll help you do it. We'll help you get there. You just have to be willing to, you know, make that decision. So David stealthily goes, and he, while Saul's sleeping, he cuts off the corner of Saul's robe, and he retrieves the robe. So what we have here is a big conflict between David's conscience and the crowd. And just so you know, forgiveness is not going to be something that your friends tell you to exercise, even godly ones. The reason why is because they care about you. But the problem is they don't realize that forgiveness is often what you need to do in order to heal from that person that's hurt you. You see, our friends often are the worst because what they do is they just care about how you're feeling. They don't care about how you are really going to heal. They're just trying to say the right things. And it takes a really, really special kind of friend to come alongside you and say, okay, you got to knock this off. Get over yourself. Forgive this person and move on. Pastor Mike has been that person in my life forever. He has, there was one particular time I was going through a really hard time. This is some years ago, maybe 2008 or 2009. And I remember he and I were talking and he was really sympathetic at first. And then one day we were talking about the same thing, and he said, look, I'm going to give you, and he looked at his watch, he's like, I'm going to be nice to you about this for about 2 more weeks. He said, at the end of 2 weeks, I'm going to kick you in the butt and say, get over it and move on. No one cares. And I said, you are so kind. But really, most of the time, our friends, they have a hard time at being in that role, don't they? Because they just care about how you feel. They're trying to make you feel good. And that's what the crowd typically does. They try to just feed into your feelings. Our friends are often the worst when it comes to forgiveness. But this is what my job is as a pastor. You ready? It's my job to tell you this, no matter what your situation is, no exception, no other reason. There's no example I can give you that says that you're exempt from this. There are no exemptions. Forgiveness is always God's will. Forgiveness is always God's will. There is no exception clause to this. It's always God's will. So if you're in a situation where you have people that even appear godly around you and they're trying to help you and trying to get you to say, okay, well, you know, who cares how this person is trying to get forgiveness from you? Don't forgive them. You're better than them. You're better than them. Listen, you have to listen to your conscience, which is the Holy Spirit of God telling you that forgiveness is his will. Conscience is the thing that hurts when everything else feels good. Right? People might agree with you. It's good that you're holding that grudge. It's good that you're doing this. But in our heart, in our quiet moments, we know what the right thing is. And David knows what the right thing is, even though he has this group of people that are standing around him, telling him, you don't have to let him go. You could kill him. End this. Look what David does. 1 Samuel 24, verse 7. It says, so David persuaded his men with these words and did not permit them to attack Saul. He tells them about it. He says, no, this isn't right. This is wrong. In fact, none of you are allowed to touch him either. I don't care what you think or feel. And guess what? They listened to David because David was their leader. You have to be willing to first obey what's going on in here. See, the problem is, as Christians, we become extremely gifted at ignoring the voice of God to the point where we almost mute him. And then we wonder, well, why isn't God speaking to me anymore? Well, my question is, have you listened to him the first 100 times that he spoke to you? Have you acted on what he told you to do? Or do you just like, do you just want to listen to God like he's on a repeat shuffle in your iPod, right? Like you're not going to listen actively, you're going to listen passively. But God speaks in a still small voice, and that still small voice often is contrary to the crowd around you. Listen to your conscience and not the crowd when it comes to forgiveness. Forgiveness is always God's will. It's always God's will. I'm going to be a little more sensitive about forgiveness in a moment, but right now I just need you to trust me. Read through the New Testament and look at how much is in there. I can't even contain all the verses in one sermon about forgiveness. Second of all, here, show respect instead of ridicule. Show respect instead of ridicule. Now, David, he cut that little piece of cloth off of Saul's robe. And I skipped this verse, and we don't have to go to it, but the Bible says that when he did that, in verse 5, it says that his heart struck him. So he was ridiculing Saul. In a sense, thank you, PowerPoint person, for doing better at the sermon than me. He ridiculed Saul because he could have killed him. And now he has a piece of his robe, his royal Louis Vuitton robe. I don't know who made it back then. I'm not sure who the designers were in that day, but it was fancy, I would imagine, because he's the king of Israel. So it says in this, in verse 8, Saul gets up after his nap and he leaves. David follows him. In verse 8, it says, afterwards, David also arose, went out of the cave and called after Saul, my lord, the king. And when Saul looked behind him, David bowed with his face to the earth and paid homage. Let me tell you, I would have killed to be a part of that scene, just to watch Saul turn around and be like, whoa, in slow motion as David, the man that he's pursuing, is behind him. He could take him out. Saul would probably lose in a fight to David, and Saul was standing there speechless, and instead of David picking up a sword, David puts his face on the ground and humbly prostrates himself before Saul and says, my lord the king, and he pays him homage. He respects the office of the king that God had placed before the nation of Israel. Why is this such an important lesson in forgiveness? Did you ever notice that unforgiveness and bitterness tends to go upward? Did you notice that? It tends to go with authority figures. We get really bitter about our bosses. get bitter about people that were in some position. One of the reasons why you're a bitter person is because at some point along the way in some position of authority, whether it's your father, your mother, your grandfather, grandmother, uncle, aunt, somebody in some position of authority over you did something. They hurt you. They caused you great pain. And what's happened is you have a bitterness going on inside of you because somebody above you hurt you in that way. Some employer took advantage of you. Somebody that was in a management position exploited your work efforts. And because of it, you have a bitterness in you because bitterness tends to rise upward, just like heat. Nothing is truer in this current political climate, amen? Are we living in a pretty bitter country right now? I've never seen anything like this in my life. I mean, politically speaking, I just have never seen anything like this. Everybody's bitter and upset about something, and nobody agrees on what they're bitter or upset about. The people that voted for the candidate that's in office, they're bitter about things. The people that didn't vote for him are bitter about things. There's people that didn't vote at all, and they're bitter about things. Everybody's upset. They're angry. They're hurting. It's only getting worse, isn't it? It's not getting better. Because bitterness, unforgiveness, hatred always tends to go upward. Always. And so David, and this is something that might, for some of you that may be dissatisfied with the political and disenfranchised with the political system of this country, this is a verse that I've clung to, especially in years past where maybe we didn't get the Christian candidate that we hoped for in office. This is a verse that I've used repeatedly in my heart, Romans chapter 13, verse 1. And this is what David applies in his relationship with Saul. It says, let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. That's pretty heavy, isn't it? Paul says in Romans that there's no ruler that hasn't been placed there by God. You know what Paul was dealing with? Paul was dealing with a ruler, a Roman ruler, that murdered Christians in droves. And Paul says, I have to respect him because that's God's ruler. What? I'm not talking about somebody that differs from opinion on how we handle Social Security and Medicare. We're talking about major, major, major acceptance of God's sovereignty. Because I don't care what's going on in our political system. We still have a God who's in control. Amen? We still have a God who's on his throne. He's sovereign. He is righteous. He is perfect. He didn't fall asleep on election day and wake up and go, oh, man, what did they do? No, he is God. He will never not be God. He will never be less than God. And therefore, I can trust him, and I don't have to ridicule. I can show respect for others and not ridicule. And in forgiveness, when we have to forgive someone, we can still disagree, but we can be agreeable in our disagreement. We can still respect someone instead of ridiculing them. This is what we're commanded to do. And notice here, let me give you a little gold nugget of this story. Notice that Saul leaves the cave. David, if I was David, I don't know about you, I would have stayed in the cave. If I'm not going to kill him, I don't want to have a fight with him. I mean, he's so twisted with rage. He wants to kill me. So I would have been like, dude, we're going to hang out here for a couple days. Go get me some water. Get me somebody's Netflix password because I'm not leaving this cave. But what does David do? David approaches Saul in the midst of this turmoil and approaches him in apology for what? For cutting off that robe and for being ridiculing to him. I'm going to give you a little bit of wisdom of something that I've gleaned over the years from counseling. Now, remember, I've been in the ministry. This will be 13 years. And one thing I've noticed about counseling people, it's this, okay? I deal with couples on a regular basis. And I used to, I have somebody that calls the pastor, Sam, my husband is being a jerk, and I want to come in and get some counseling, or my wife is being this way, and I want to come in and get some counseling. Can we talk? And they'll come in, and basically for an hour, they tell me how they married the Antichrist. That's where we're at. You know, they say that at night they have horns, and, you know, it's bad. And then, you know, I commiserate with them for an hour, and I feel, oh, I'm so sorry, that's terrible, and we'll pray, you know. And I realized after a couple years that I don't really know what's going on in that house because I only get one perspective. So now when I meet with couples, now there are exceptions, but they're few. If a couple wants marriage counseling, if somebody says, I need marriage counseling, I'm going to come and I say, well, you have to bring your spouse because the truth is somewhere in the middle. And the only way you get to the bottom of a solution is to really have everybody get on the table. Now, this is what I've learned. This is really going to help you, okay? This is free advice. When there's a conflict, whether it be marital or whether it be a conflict that's just between two people, the person that is willing to come and say, I want to meet with this person, get everything on the table, and resolve this because I don't know where this went wrong, 9 times out of 10, notice I said 9 times out of 10 because there's always, people can be weird sometimes, okay? 9 times out of 10, the person that's willing to come and put everything on the table is typically more right than the person that says, I'm not talking, I can't do that, I'm not going to get anything on the table, I just want nothing to do with that person, I don't want to resolve it. Typically, that person is trying to hide something, okay? That's just a free tidbit of advice. I'm not going to charge you. I was, but I'm not, okay? David, he has nothing to hide. He didn't do anything. In fact, he wants this conflict resolved. If you see when Saul dies later, David cries for him. He cries. David's heart is blameless before God in this situation. And David approaches Saul. And David tries to get to the bottom of the situation, regardless of how David has been wronged. Now, many of the people in your lives, and I'm going to say this very delicately, I know that people have hurt you, but in David's case, this person is trying to murder him, repeatedly trying to murder him. That's pretty heavy. That's pretty dysfunctional. But what does the Bible tell us when somebody does evil to us? Romans chapter 12, verse 17, Paul says, repay no one evil for evil. Repay no one evil for evil. Let me tell you what this means to me. You ready? This is what I live by, and this is a moment that I think might change some of your lives. I will not permit my character to be determined by someone who has hurt me. Meaning, I will not let someone who has offended me and hurt me and done wrong and victimized me, I will not say, well, because they did this, I'm going to behave this way. I will not. Over my dead body will I allow my character to be compromised because someone is evil. I will not. What I will do is I will forgive them. I will follow along the lines of what God wants me to do because at the end of the day, the only person's opinion that I care about that matters the most is what God thinks about how I handled the situation. This happens repeatedly. Over and over again in our lives, doesn't it? We have the opportunity that somebody hurts you. Somebody's done something wrong to you. And I have this conversation. I'm going to have this conversation with my kids. Say, well, so-and-so, they said really bad things about you. This happened not too long ago. My wife was talking to me. And my wife, she gets it because we've been together a long time and she understands. And she knows how I'm going to be about certain situations. There was a really weird situation that happened. She goes, this person hates you. I said, yeah, I know. She goes, they hate your guts. I said, I know. She goes, why are you so nice to them? I said, because I'm not going to let them determine how I behave. You think I'm going to let someone that hates me determine how I act? They are who they are because of who they are, and I am who I am because of Jesus Christ. Don't let your character, don't let the grace of God be limited in your life because of someone that hurt you. Don't give that kind of control to them. Why do we do that? Why do we enable them to make a, well, because this person did this, I'm going to do this. What you're doing is you're giving them more power to continue to hurt you because the only person that you're hurting is yourself by allowing your character to be chiseled away. Why do we do that? Why? We don't realize how damaging, how bitterness can kill us slowly but surely every day as we replay that offense and as we become people that God never intended us to be. To illustrate this a little more clearly, there were two men that rode the train every single day to work. One guy was like a normal guy, and the other guy, let's call him the know-it-all guy. Everybody has a know-it-all guy in their life, right? Like the one-upper. You know what I'm talking about. Some of you are laughing, and the ones that aren't laughing, that's probably because you are that person. I'm just being serious again. Okay, so the two people on the train, there's the guy, regular guy, then there's the know-it-all guy. And every single time the know-it-all guy would have a conversation with this other guy, they'd talk about something like the regular guy, he's like, I bought a Mac last week. And he's like, oh, let me tell you, I've been using Macs for years. And he would poke him in the chest, just keep poking him in the chest. And let me tell you, you were wrong about this. And every single day, this guy would poke him in the chest to prove a point, regardless of what the conversation was, politics, religion, workplace, everything. This guy was just so annoying. And this guy hated know-it-all. He hated his guts so much until one day he came to the train super duper early, and he had kind of a smile on his face. He got there before know-it-all got there, and he sat in the normal seat. One of their acquaintances was walking down the aisle. He noticed that the man was sitting there by himself. He said to the guy, he said, "Hey, man, where's your friend?" He goes, "The guy you're always sitting there arguing with every single day, where is he?" He says, "Who, know-it-all?" He's like, "Yeah, where is he?" He's like, "Oh, I got here a little early before him today." He goes, "Because I got a surprise for him." And the guy said, "What's that?" He said, "Well," he said, "do you ever notice how every single time he wants to prove a point, he pokes me in the chest, he pokes me in the stomach? You know how annoying that is?" He's like, "Yeah, it is pretty annoying." He's like, "Well, guess what? I got a surprise for him today." And the man opened up his coat to reveal that he had 3 sticks of dynamite taped to his chest. He said, "When he pokes me today, I'm going to blow his hand off." Some of you are like, "Wait, won't he hurt himself?" Yeah, that's the... Good job. Some of you are on that Island of Misfit Toys still. You're playing with Charlie in the box. When we are bitter and unforgiving, we are taking poison to kill somebody else. We're allowing ourselves to be limited and broken where God has desired us to be free. This is the part in the sermon where people are going to say, "Pastor Sam, you simply don't understand what I've been through. You don't know how I've been hurt. You don't know what that person did to me. You don't know what that feels like. I'm going to save you the time in that conversation. I'm going to say you're absolutely right. I do not know what it feels like to walk the road that you've walked. I do not know what it's like to be victimized the way you have. And I'm being completely sincere. This is not a joke. I have talked to people, counseled people who have been raped. I've talked to people that have been molested by loved ones, people they trusted. I've talked to people that have been severely abused by their spouses, people that they trust. Over and over again in different ways, I can't comprehend it. I really can't, I'll be honest. But what I'm going to suggest to you now is the way that you have to get over this conflict. And this is the way that David got in perspective with his conflict with Saul. Look with me in 1 Samuel chapter 24, verse 12. He says to Saul, "May the Lord judge between me and you. May the Lord avenge me against you, but my hand shall not be against you." David, on his hands and knees before Saul, lifts up his voice and says, "I am not going to take the bait when it comes to this conflict. I am not going to raise my hand to you. I am not going to question the authority that God has placed in you. I will not compromise myself. This is God's job to deal with you. I am not going to take this any further. I'm sorry. I'm sorry that I did what I did. I'm sorry that I cut the rope, but I am not raising my hand to you. This is between me, you, and God. God's going to handle the conflict." It has to be the way that you get when it comes to forgiving those who have hurt you. You have to let God handle the conflict. You have to. You have to trust him enough to handle. You say, "But Pastor Sam, I've been wronged. I've been hurt. I've been victimized." This is one thing you have to realize about sin that's been committed on this earth. You ready? This is heavy, but listen to it, church. Every wrong deed ever committed will either be covered by the blood of Christ or repaid justly by God at the final judgment. Every wrong deed. There is no sin that God has overlooked. God has not forgotten you in your pain. God has not left you abandoned in that. He will not deal with sin. But every single sin that has ever been committed will either be covered by the blood of Jesus Christ or it will be dealt with at the final day of judgment. A preacher wisely once said, "If God is going to judge in the end times, why am I jumping the gun and judging now?" It's not going to solve any problem. It's not. And there are two incorrect theological problems that you have if you are a bitter person. If you are sitting here right now and you can't forgive someone, there's two big theological loopholes that you're having a problem with. Number one, you are proving that you have not truly comprehended the power of the gospel. The gospel is that Jesus Christ died for the unloving. He died for the unlovable. He shed his blood. He poured his life out to free sinful mankind. Did we do anything to earn that? Yes or no? Say it. Did we do anything to deserve that? Yes or no? But he forgave us. He chose to forgive us. He chose to show his love by offering the only thing that we couldn't do, and that is be forgiven. He gave us all of that. So when we truly have been transformed by the forgiveness of Christ, we become forgiving. Second of all, what we're saying, theologically speaking, when we refuse to forgive someone is that God can handle creating the universe in 6 days. God can handle literally sustaining the cells of my body so that my heart continues to beat. God can handle all these things. However, he needs my help when it comes to human relations. Because he can't quite handle this conflict. He doesn't know what he's doing up there because I would do this a lot differently. I believe my God can handle all of it. He can handle who's hurt me. He can handle my hurt. Last thing, I'm going to make this quick. Last thing I want to teach you about forgiveness, and this one's kind of a bonus point. It's like the point that is part of the sermon, but not really. Number three, this is one of the reasons why a lot of us don't forgive. Number three, resolve the conflict without restoring confidence. Resolve the conflict without restoring confidence. Look with me in 1 Samuel chapter 24, verse 22. It says, David swore this to Saul. He said he'd never heard him. But it says, then Saul went home. I think they fist bumped. Okay, Saul's like, I'm going home to the palace. I'm not pursuing you anymore. And David's like, okay. And then David went back up into the stronghold. He didn't go home with him. He didn't go order a movie with him and go grab Domino's. They didn't have a camaraderie. David went back into hiding. Do you know why? Because David knew Saul. For those of you that know this story, was this the last time that Saul tried to kill David? Yes or no? No. Saul will go to his grave trying to kill David. And David will leave and flee him and never try to engage him in battle because David promised that he wouldn't. Just because you've forgiven someone does not mean you have to reinstate them in a position where they can hurt you again. Hear me on that. That's freeing. I hear this from couples all the time. Couples that are arguing and dating couples, not married couples. There'll be like a really nice girl and she's godly. And she's like, well, Pastor Sam, he's abusive to me and he cheated on me and he's really mean to me and he's nasty. But, you know, Jesus says we should forgive, so I should take him back, right? I'm like, dude, you can forgive him, but I would take him to Dumpsville. You do not have to enable bad behavior. Forgiveness is not enabling bad behavior. Forgiveness is allowing yourself to be released from the pain that this person has caused you and trusting that God will deal with them on that pain. That's all forgiveness is. You have to be willing to forgive. And you have to be willing to remember the words of Christ himself, the paragon of forgiveness, the living virtue of forgiveness, as Jesus said in the Beatitudes, Matthew chapter 5, verse 44, I say to you, love your enemies. And pray for those who persecute you. The way that we can do that is we remember the example that Christ gave us and that he suffered for us. We don't deserve it. Just like the person that hurt you doesn't deserve your forgiveness, but don't let your character be compromised by person that hurt you. Free someone today from the prison of unforgiveness. And it's not the offender, it's yourself. It's yourself. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your love. And I pray in Jesus' name that you would heal us. I know everyone struggles with unforgiveness. I pray that today you'd convict us. I pray we'd listen to our conscience and not the crowd. I pray that you would speak into our lives. Allow us to be applicants of the grace that we have received, that we would also extend that grace to those that have hurt us. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.